Why don't we stand and worship the Lord? Our God is good. He's worthy of our praise. Let's worship him with everything we got this morning. Come on, let's sing this out.
Together to praise his name, to come together as a community and be reminded of who God is. We need to be reminded. We need to be with brothers and sisters who help us be able to endure, to be able to persevere. And I don't know what kind of week you're walking in with. Maybe you had a week where you felt such a nearness to God, or maybe you're having a week where you are really struggling, but God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we can gather together and worship Him and praise Him today. So I want to read this over us. Psalm 97 says, "The Lord reigns. Let the earth rejoice. Let the many coastlands be glad. Clouds and darkness are all around Him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of His throne. Fire goes before Him and burns up His adversaries all around. His lightnings light up the world. The fire sees and trembles. The mountains melt like wax before the Lord, before the Lord of all the earth. The heavens proclaim His righteousness, and all the peoples see His glory. All worshipers of images are put to shame, who make their boast in worthless idols. Worship Him, all you gods. Zion hears and is glad, and the daughters of Judah rejoice because of your judgments, O Lord. For you, O Lord, are most high over all the earth. You are exalted far above all gods. O you who love the Lord, hate evil. He perseveres the lives of His saints. He delivers them from the hand of the wicked. Light is sown for the righteous, and the joy for the upright in heart. Righteous, rejoice in the Lord, O you righteous, and give thanks to His holy name." And as we are here, we know God is righteous and He sustains us. So we get to sing to Him, a righteous God who deserves all the praise.
Rocks cry out to worship. Whose glory taught the stars to shine? Perhaps creation longs to have the words to sing. But this joy is
let's sing this out. With one voice, a thousand generations will sing, worthy is the Lamb. Eternity with you, Lord. We love you so much. You are such a good God to us. We thank you for being here this morning. Pray all these things in your name. Amen. Guys, why don't you turn to somebody you didn't come to church with? Say hello. Welcome them to church.
Well, hey, good morning, Harvest family. It's great to worship with you. It's great to be together. My name is Larry Geisler. I get to serve as the pastor of Harvest Students and Harvest Young Adults. And if this is your first time here, I just want to say welcome. We're so glad that you decided to join us. I'd love to meet you. Our staff would love to get to know you. So after the service, we just want you to know, I'll be out in the lobby. Some of our staff would be there. We'd love to answer any questions you might have about our church. We'd love to get to know you, the story of how God brought you here today. So please come and stop by our welcome table in the lobby after service and chat with us for a little while. And for everyone here, we want you to know it's our goal as a church, as a staff, that all of us together, we grow as disciples of Christ. And we want to care for you. And one of the ways that we do that is through our Connect card. The Connect card you can find on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. You can find it by scanning a QR code on a seat in front of you. What it does is it lets us know that you're here. But also it gives you an opportunity to submit any prayer requests that you have. So anything that you're burdened with, anything that you're hopeful in prayer towards, anything that you're celebrating, as a staff, we want to celebrate that with you. We want to lift up these prayers with you. So if you submit a prayer request there, know that our staff prays for those every single week, and we would love to be able to celebrate when God answers those prayers. So please do that as well while you fill out the Connect card. But as many of you know, yesterday was Veterans Day. And so we want to take a time to honor and acknowledge so many people in this country and across the world who have given their lives, who have willingly sacrificed so much to put themselves in the line of danger, to protect the weak and the vulnerable from those who wish to do evil in this world. And I just want to read this verse because I think it accurately describes the perspective of those who are willing to put themselves in danger. This is John 15, 13. Jesus says that greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. And there are many across the world who live with this perspective. I'm willing to put myself in danger that others might be protected. The weak and the vulnerable who can't protect themselves, I want to do that for them. And so if you're a veteran in the room, would you just stand up so that we can honor you and celebrate you today? Can you guys stand up or just give us a wave or give them a round of applause? Thank you to each one of you for doing a work that's more than just something that has to do with a country, but that has to do with protecting those who can't protect themselves, and that is the character of our God to do that for us. So thank you so much for the work that each one of you has done. And as we continue to worship the Lord this morning, we're going to direct our attention towards giving. And I want to read this passage for us because this passage reflects a heart of hope in the Lord and the kingdom of heaven and what is awaiting us, rather than a hope in what we have now. This is Matthew 6, 19 through 21. It says, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." So when we look at the things that we have on this earth, when we look at our money and our possessions, they're good, but they're not what this is about. This life that we live is not about hope in possessions. Our hope is in Christ. That's where we're headed. And so when we get to give towards the kingdom of God. We get to give towards the furthering of the gospel message in our area, across the world, because that's what matters. And so we give cheerfully, knowing that God has been so good to us and given us more than we could ever ask or imagine. And so you can give in any of the ways that you see on the screen here. You can drop your gift in a blue box in the back of the room on your way out, or you might give during the week, and that's great. We just want to give with a cheerful heart to the Lord for all that he has done for us. And I want to take some time to pray for that offering, but I'd also love to pray for a local church in our area that is like-minded to us and is preaching the gospel and was actually planted out of Harvest Bible Chapel. This is City Line Bible Church in Niles. Their pastor is Mo Zachariah, And we're going to take some time to pray for them this morning as well. So would you just join me as we pray for these offerings, we pray for City Line, and we pray for our gathering this morning. Father, we come to you, and Lord, we recognize you are the reason we're here. We're not here just to see friends. We're not here just to make an appearance, but God, we are here to encounter you. For God, there is no one greater than you. There's no one more worthy of our worship, nor more worthy of our time than you are. And so, Lord, we're humbled to be in your presence. And God, as we give our offerings to you in joy, for you have given us so much, Lord, we just pray that you bless these offerings, that God, you use them, you multiply them for the furthering of the gospel in our community, that many might come to know you, that you might open up doors into our community, that you would use these funds, these offerings, to bring the gospel to people who need to know you. And Lord, we pray for City Line Bible Church. God, we thank you that you've placed a church in Niles that loves you, that loves the gospel and wants to bring that gospel message to their community. So Lord, we pray that you open the right doors for them. Lord, we pray for Pastor Mo, that God, you give him wisdom as to what you're leading them into. God, what is the mission of City Line Bible Church? Lord, would you speak that clearly to him, that he would give direction to the congregation, that they might have great gospel impact, that you'd be honored and glorified, that your name be lifted high through all that they do in the city of Niles. And Lord, we pray for Pastor Jeff as he opens your word this morning. Lord, would your spirit speak through him in a very real and tangible way. Lord, would we not leave today without recognizing your spirit is speaking to us. Give us ears to hear what you have to say. Would you give Pastor Jeff the confidence, the boldness to speak your word to us this morning? And so, Lord, we lift these things up to you. We give you the praise and the honor and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
It's good to see you. Yeah. Look, if you have a Bible, I want to invite you to open it to Acts chapter 16. Acts chapter 16. We're going to be studying the first 10 verses of Acts 16. If you don't know who I am, my name is Jeff. I'm one of the pastors here, and I get the privilege of teaching God's word most weeks. We're going to look at this really great passage, which, you know, it's the kind of passage actually you probably run by and not really pay a whole lot of attention to in the book of Acts because you're trying to get to something more interesting. But this is going to be very interesting and really have a lot to say to people like you and me. You ever seen the movie Untouchables? That's a dated film reference. Late 1980s, so those of us who are men in the room, we've seen this many times because Untouchables was like one of those tombstone kind of movies where you just get super excited about the fight between Al Capone's folks and Elliot Ness's folks. It was a story about how actually Al Capone came to justice and how Elliot Ness was able to jail him ultimately for tax evasion. But it describes a story of the fight that went on between the FBI and Capone's gang here in Chicago. There's a scene in this film that is hard to watch. It's actually when Sean Connery, who is Elliot Ness's buddy and is the one who's pushing Elliot Ness to be committed to the cause of seeing Capone's downfall. And he keeps asking him the question, what are you prepared to do? What are you prepared to do? And Elliot Ness is like, well, I'm prepared to do anything within the law. And he says, yeah, but then what are you prepared to do? Because the only way that you're going to get the only way you're going to get Capone is if you're willing to go beyond what he's willing to do. And he's willing to do a lot to avoid being arrested. Anyway, it's It's been like 30 years for the film, okay, so I'm going to give away one part of it. Sean Connery's character dies, and he's lying there on the ground because he's been all shot up. And Elliot Ness shows up, and he's hovering over him, and the last words that this guy says, spitting blood out of his mouth, Connery says, "What are you prepared to do?" I actually think that that's a line. What are you prepared to do is a line actually that, if I could summarize, a lot of what Jesus calls people to when it comes to following him, I actually think those are probably his words. Like, if you want to come and follow me, what are you prepared to do? Stories of guys leaving their nets behind, leaving their families behind, leaving everything behind to come and follow him. What does it look like, actually, to follow Christ? What kind of commitment is required to follow Jesus? What should we be willing to do? Or prepared to do if we want to follow him? So I think Acts 16, the first 10 verses, gives a couple of really poignant answers. And it, simply these two. I think in order to follow Jesus, you need to be willing to go and willing to wait. Willing to go and willing to wait. So let's have a look at both of those. First, I think you need to be willing to go. Acts chapter 16, verse 1. So Paul came also to Derbe and Lystra. There's a context, of course, to this. If you remember, last time we left our heroes, Paul and Barnabas, good buddies who've been traveling all over the place, they had a fight. It was called a sharp disagreement, and they split up. So this is my map of the ancient world, which, again, I don't draw maps well. Look, it's a fish. Anyway, sorry. Okay, so basically, Jerusalem's here. Syrian Antioch is up here. They left from Jerusalem. Paul and Barnabas have this big fight, and one goes that way, one goes this way. Paul and Silas are up this region now. Now, Lystra and Derbe are up in this sort of northern region. It's in modern-day Turkey. So they've traveled up to this location, and they came to Derbe and to Lystra. This little word, Lystra, should bring back some memories. If you've been studying with us in the book of Acts, the last time that the Apostle Paul was in Lystra was when a bunch of Jewish opponents came in, spread a bad report about him, and had the rulers of the city drag him out, thinking he was dead outside the city, and leave him there. So I don't know about you, but if somebody had dragged me out to the outskirts of Indianapolis, I probably wouldn't go back. There's not a lot in Indianapolis that's worth going and seeing anyway. But I'm kidding. But if they had tried to kill me, I wouldn't go back. But here's Paul. He cares about the church enough that he's going to go back to Lystra to try to encourage these dear folks. Now, when he gets to Lystra, a disciple was there, and his name was Timothy. Now, you should know that name if you know your Bible. There's two books in the Bible called 1 and 2 Timothy, and they were written to this guy. In fact, 2 Timothy is the last book that Paul ever wrote in his entire life. They are his dying words. So this guy is a pretty important dude to the Apostle Paul. He's his protege. He's called his son in the faith. Like, so Paul sees him as a son. Not yet. This is the first time they meet him. This is the time that they say, "Hey, young man, come and join us." So a disciple was there named Timothy. He was the son of a Jewish woman who was a believer, but his father was a Greek. This is actually pretty important. Why? Well, Jewish lineage was tied to your mother. So if you have a Jewish mom, you're considered Jewish and along that ethnicity. Circumcision was the thing that Jewish parents did to their kids to demonstrate that those kids were part of what we call the covenant community, that we are part of the nation of Israel, and it's a sign that I am committed to the Lord and I'm dedicated to him. But Greek people, all right, like Roman citizen type folks whose names were like Suetonius, they thought that circumcision was barbaric. But the Jews said, no, it's actually a sign of the covenant that we have with God. So here you have this woman who's Jewish, but she's married a Greek man. This marriage would have been considered by most Jewish people just totally out of bounds. I don't know if you remember in the Old Testament where the people of Israel go across into the promised land, and the big command was, do not intermarry with the people of the land, because they will draw your hearts away from God. This was something that was carried on throughout ages. They don't intermarry with people, with Gentiles. Don't intermarry with people whose hearts are not committed to God, because what will end up happening is you'll have a kid and he won't be circumcised and he won't be part of the covenant community. Well, here we got Timothy, who is the embodiment of that issue. One more thing. In those days, if you met me, the first thing that we would talk about would be my family. I know we don't do that in our society, because most of us, I mean, in Chicagoland, for example, people come from all over. That's usually we ask people, where are you from and what do you do, right? Because for us, those are kind of the most important things. And when we ask, where are you from, we're just asking you, so, you know, where are you from? Los Angeles. Oh, I've been to Los Angeles. And now we can talk a little bit about Sunset Strip or whatever. But in those days, in fact, most days in the history of the world, the thing that was most important about you is, who's your daddy? Whose family are you a part of? If you go to some small towns today, you'll get that. Something like, oh, you Daryl's kid? So if you put all of that together, here's what you get. Everyone who met Timothy, if they take him on the mission, everybody they meet who is Jewish, the first thing they're going to ask Timothy is, who's your daddy? His response is going to be Suetonius or whatever. And they are immediately going to be, wait a minute, how are you? You're a Jewish kid. Your mom's Jewish. Your dad is Greek. We don't need to do any further investigation about, you know, what's going on with your body parts to determine that you're apostate. And because you're apostate, you don't get to come and speak into the synagogues at all. So when Paul calls this guy, it is a little bit of a problem. It would be much easier if he had just called somebody who is, you know, fully Jewish. His parents had done all the right things, but that's not Timothy. He was well spoken of by the brothers at Lystra and Iconium. This is a big city that's further away from Lystra. It's a, you know, so the Christian community, both in his town, which was a little bit of a rural town, and the nearby city, all spoke well of him, which is like saying, hey, look, everybody speaks well of him in Rockford and Chicago. So he's well known, model kid, and Paul wanted Timothy to accompany him. And he took him and he circumcised him because of the Jews who were in those places. For they all knew that his father was a Greek. And you did, right? All of us know your father's a Greek. We're not going to let you into our community. So circumcision is, it is. And as they went on their way through the cities, they delivered to them being, of course, the different churches that have been planted. This is their second missionary journey, so they're going and visiting all of these churches that they already planted. Now they're coming along, and they're delivering to them for observance the decisions that had been reached by the apostles and elders who were in Jerusalem. Remember in Acts 15, they all get together and they make a decision about whether or not you need to, listen, about whether or not you need to be circumcised to be a good Christian. Okay, Luke means this ironically. I'm sure he does. Because what he's done here is basically said, just picture Timothy, okay, he gets circumcised as an early 20-year-old man, and then he goes on this mission trip with Paul, and their job is to carry this, first the message of the gospel, and to clarify for the churches that, remember those false teachers who came through and told you need both Jesus and circumcision to be a good Christian? You don't. So Paul pulls out, his doc, I just picture it. He pulls out his scroll and he starts reading and he says, okay, hear ye, everybody. Here's what the Jerusalem Council says. You do not need, I know you've heard that you need to be circumcised to be a good Christian, but it is not necessary for you to be circumcised. And I picture Timothy over going, wait, what? What? This would have been good to know. Now, it's probably not like that. I'm sure that Timothy knew. And the reason I say I'm sure he's new, because this whole passage is trying to explain to everybody how committed this Timothy guy is, both to the mission of God and to God himself. Anything the Lord calls him to do, he's going to do. If it means furthering the gospel, he's in. That's why he was well spoken of. So the churches were strengthened in the faith, and they increased in numbers daily because of this kid's willingness to go and to do these particular things. Now look, Luke holds Timothy up here as a model disciple willing to sacrifice for the Lord regardless of the cost, and it was a cost. What we're supposed to do when we read this passage is we're supposed to take note of this. Luke didn't just decide that he was going to write about Timothy. Oh, yeah, that's right. I got to say something about when Timothy showed up. The way he writes about this is similar to the way he wrote about Barnabas, who was well-loved by all the... Like, he's basically saying, I got to tell you about these amazing Christian guys. And when I tell you about these amazing Christian guys, I want to give you a picture of what genuine discipleship looks like. And that's what he's doing with this kid. Genuine disciples are willing to go. Where? Wherever. At what cost? At whatever cost. It means we surrender. Genuine Christians are marked by their willingness to give up to the Lord and say, Lord, this is your, I am yours. My lips are yours. My brain is yours. My hands are yours. My future is yours. My money is yours. My everything belongs to you. Okay, so can I... Objection! Wait a minute, Jeff, what are you doing here? What you've taken, though, is you've taken a passage of scripture that describes missionaries, and you're saying that what is true of missionaries should be true of all Christians. Don't you know, Jeff, that there are categories of Christians? There are some people who really committed to Jesus, missionaries, pastors, people who give a lot of money, people who plant churches. There's those people, and then there's the everyone else. So this passage should not be applied to people who are just everyone else. It's supposed to be talked about as missionaries. So I'm willing to say that missionaries should be really committed to the Lord and willing to go wherever the Lord calls them. But I've not been called. So don't apply this to me. Don't say that this level of commitment is due me, okay? No, actually not okay. I know that in the Christian church, I've been drawing this last week. I've been teaching some classes this last week. And so I've been drawing this picture for people because it's a common picture that's been used in lots of churches and Christian circles that are kind of in our, frame of experience. And it's this. So how it goes is this is the line of belief, meaning that if you're under the line, you don't believe in Jesus, and you're above the line, you do. If you believe in Jesus or don't believe in Jesus, we would say that Jesus is outside of your life. There's a throne in your life, but Jesus is outside of the throne in your life. He's outside your life altogether. And because of this, right, you will have a Christless eternity. Because you don't want him in your life, you won't have him forever and ever and ever. Above the line, though, there are different kinds of Christians. By the way, I'm just describing the way that the Christian church has taught publicly for lots and lots of years. Above the line, you, of course, have your life, and you can have Jesus in your life, but not on the throne. So you know, this you're saved, but you're not fully committed. You're not Timothy, right? The Timothys of the world are a different kind of Christian. They're the ones who have Jesus in their life, and he's on the throne. So, of course, everybody needs to be here. Of course, we want everyone to be with Jesus on the throne of their life. But if you don't, it's okay. You're still saved. It just means you won't, I don't know, get extra credit in heaven. You won't live in the best communities or whatever in the new heavens and new earth. But you'll still be there. So according to this, there are two kinds of Christian people. Actually, no. And when I say no, I mean when you get into the scriptures, one of the things that you learn very quickly is actually when Jesus calls people, as Dietrich Bonhoeffer said, he bids them come and die. That to be a Christian is to submit and bow your knee to the King and surrender everything to him. That's normal for everyone. There's no special missionary faith. People go out on missions, have the same faith that you have, the same faith that I have, the same faith that an accountant has, same faith that the homemaker has, same faith that. You're just a Christian. And so the question is, what are Christians expected to do in terms of their commitment? Oh, okay, let's take a short tour. The book of Mark, chapter 8, verse 34. Calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he, Jesus, said to them, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. This is about a necklace though, right? Seriously, isn't that a crazy thing for you to say in the first century when the cross was an instrument of torture? It was like the worst thing possible. And of course, Jesus is speaking about where he's headed. And he's saying, listen, if you want to come after me, you got to follow me no matter how far it goes. And it might mean death, but if you want to come after me, you deny yourself, turn away from yourself, pick up your cross, and you follow me. Wherever it is that I go, for whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life, surrenders to me, says, I am no longer my own. You get to define for me all of the things. My full allegiance is to you, Jesus, and you alone. Whoever loses his life for my sake and for the gospel's will save it. Luke 14. Verse 25, great crowds accompanied him. And he turned and he said to them, wouldn't you think this would be a great moment for the soft message? When the crowds are here, Jesus, don't say anything to tick them off, right? Just, we finally got them to come. Just don't ruin it. Great crowds accompanied him, and he turned and said to them, if anyone comes to me, that's what they're all doing, Jesus. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, this is easy. Yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And you and I are like, what are you talking about? Hate. Well, look, what he means is turn away from. Your allegiance is no longer to your family. It's no longer to your spouse. It's no longer to any. It's to Jesus. Anyone who comes to me and doesn't hate father, mother, wife, children, brothers, sisters, yes, even his own life. He can't be my disciple. Wait a minute. What do you, you cannot, right? He doesn't say he cannot be my missionaries, cannot be my extra special credits. They cannot be a disciple. Whoever does not bear his own cross, there it is again, and come after me, cannot be my disciple. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 20. Simple phrase, for you were bought with a price. What's that from? What kind of language is that? Well, it's from the slave market. And he intends it to be from the slave market. You were bought with a price. You were for sale. You actually were a slave of sin and the devil. And the Lord came along and said, I want that one. He redeemed you. Hear the language. He purchased you so that you are now free. Yes, free from the devil, but you're not free from the slavery to Christ. So glorify God in your body. Because whose body is it? The one who bought you. You ever noticed in the beginning of the books, at the beginning of some of the books, here's Paul writing later with Timothy. This is the book to Philippians, the first verse of Philippians. He says, Paul and Timothy, servants, this Greek word is actually the word slave. And it's supposed to be the word slave. Have you ever signed at the bottom of a letter? For me, Jeff Bucknam, doctor, THM, BA, and then I throw in as many certificates I got for whatever there. You want to impress people. You're defining yourself with your education, your experience, or my title, lead pastor of teaching and vision. What is the title that Paul, the apostle, chooses for himself when he writes to the Philippians? He chooses slave. Why does he use the word slave? Well, because Jeffy was bought with a price. Because his understanding of himself is as a servant, like a servant without a choice for this Savior, for this one who came and purchased him. He's a slave, and that has all of the significance that it's supposed to have for him. Following Jesus means commitment. It means surrender. When God calls us, he bids us come and die. There were one of my favorite little stories that I'm not even sure it's true, but I love it. It's actually about this group of indigenous people during one of the wars that Great Britain got into in Southeast Asia a number of years ago. Anyway, they were trying to get in behind the lines of the enemy, but they didn't have a way, thick forest, right? Thick jungle, and they didn't have a way to get into that area because, nobody would have the courage to jump into that area with paratroopers and stuff, at least at that time. They just didn't have the people. So they went to a local tribe called the Gurkhas. And they said they were allies with the Gurkhas. And they said, would you guys be willing to jump out of an airplane and land behind the enemy lines and try to take the ground for us so that we can then bring our military in? And the Gurkha tribe leader said, well, okay, let me think about it. We're gonna have a council meeting. And so they went away and they had a council meeting, came back to the British commander, and they said, we're willing to do it on two promises from you. Number one, we need you to fly really slow. And number two, you can't fly any higher than 1,000 feet off the ground. And the commander's like, we can't do that. We can't fly that slow, that close to ground, and there will be no time for your parachutes to open. And the Gurkha leader said, oh, we'll have parachutes? Oh yeah, we'll do it. We'll be happy to do it. So they were ready at a 100-story high building to just jump out of an airplane as long as it was going slow enough. Okay, right, there's some commitment. Honestly, it's probably a pretty good picture of what it means to follow Jesus. Hey, I want you to jump out there. Okay! Timothy, we need you to get circumcised. Okay! You're going to suffer a whole bunch of things. Okay! Of course, you and I, when we hear that, one of the challenges that immediately comes to our mind is, yeah, that's great pastor speak, but you're going to have to give me a reason. Why commit like that? What's the motivation? Who does that? Well, I'll give you a couple of motivations. If you're a Christian, if you're somebody who believes in the Lord Jesus Christ, he died for your sins, rose on the third day for justification, and he will come again in glory. If you believe those things, I'll give you two motivations. Number one, you should do it because of what you've got. And number two, you should do it because of what you'll get. You should do it because of what you got, and you should do it because of what you'll get. What do you got? Well, let's see. Before the foundations of the world, God walked saw across the entirety of history of the world, and he chose you. He chose you. He knew your name. He reached out. He didn't pass you by. Should have passed you by. Passed by a lot of others. He reached out, said, I'll have this one, please. There was nothing to draw him to you. He took you. He made you his own. And you were born, and at a particular time in your life, the Lord orchestrated circumstances around you so that you would hear the gospel message and that you would respond in faith. So much of your history involves him orchestrating these things behind the scenes that you didn't even know about. Also, that you would come to faith in Christ. He then takes you as his own, calls you his adopted son or daughter, and promises that he's going to lavish on you all blessings forevermore. He will keep you, he said. I will, because I grabbed you and chose you from the beginning, I'm going to keep you. Regardless of how bad your desires are to turn away, I will always chase you down. You will never get away from my love. Try as we might, prone to wander, Lord, we feel it. Prone to leave the God we love. He grabs us back, he brings us home, welcomes us into his kingdom, throws on the robe over and over and over again, and then we die in Christ. At that moment, we stand before him. And he says to us, because of not our righteousness, but the righteousness that's in Jesus, that is now ours because of faith, he says, I count this one not guilty, righteous, deserving of eternal blessing because they're in Christ. Then he takes you and he places you in his heavenly kingdom and the new heavens and new earth when he returns and the entire world forever and ever. You will rule together with Christ and the other believers this new world where there is no pain, there is no heartache, there are no tears, there is only joy, and each day is better than the last. Every adventure is better than the last. Forever and ever, every morning is a new joy. Forever and ever and ever. And you had nothing in you to draw his attention. It is all of grace. So what have you got? It's hard to describe what we got. It's not like I can say, well, you've got $1 billion, because $1 billion is a pittance compared to what this is. So what have you got? Now, if you start thinking about what you've got and what the Lord has done, and it starts to get deep inside of your spirit, you start thinking to yourself, what do I do in response to something like that? What do I do, Lord? And the answer is, Give me everything. I want everything. I'll give you everything. But I want everything. And you find yourself like a woman who's breaking into a dinner party and taking her perfume and pouring it on the feet of Jesus and rubbing it with her hair and crying tears. You don't care who sees you. You don't care what people know about you. All you want to do is worship this one. That's it. Whatever you want, Lord. Whatever you want. You can have it all. Or as Paul says in Romans 12, I appeal to you therefore, brothers, based on or by the mercies of God, which he described, which I just told you about. The mercies of God in your election, salvation, glorification, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice. Holy and acceptable to God, which is, now this version says spiritual. The right thing here to say, in my opinion, is reasonable. It is a reasonable worship. It is reasonable for you to respond to that kind of grace with everything you've got laying down on an altar. So why should you commit your whole life to Christ? Because of what you got. And because of what you'll get. Well, wait a minute. What do you mean, what I'll get? Right, okay, so but Matthew 13, verse 44, Jesus says, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found. Hey, you picture yourself, you got that old man, you know, beep, 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 guy on the beach who should put more clothes on. Beep, beep, beep. Kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. Beep, 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 beep. He starts digging it up and he found it, but then he covered it back up because he doesn't want anyone else to see. And then in his joy, he goes to the real estate agent and he goes and he sells everything he has. He has a fire garage sale. And you show up to buy stuff from this guy, and he's like, you're trying to pull one over on him. So I'll take the TV for $40. Yes! He's smiling, take it all! You're like, this guy's an idiot. Selling away all the important stuff in the world. He's like, no, you can take it. You want a 2-for-1 here? In his joy, he goes and he sells all that he has and buys that. He buys that field because what he finds in that field is greater than anything he could ever have. What do you get? You get Jesus. What do you get? You get the greatest thing in the universe. The greatest knowledge, the greatest person, the greatest experience in the universe. Not for one moment, but forever and ever. Amen. So you've gotten a lot, you're getting a lot. It actually seems like it's not just reasonable, you're getting a pretty good deal for your life. That's a pretty good trade. Anything else you want to waste your life on besides that? Any greater return than that? So you got to be willing to go, second, last. You got to be willing to wait. Okay, so I'm going to give my life to Christ, and it's going to mean everything. All right, Lord, lead the way. Lord's like, yep, let's do that. Verse 6, and they went through the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. Phrygia, Galatia, Asia. And when they had come up to Mysia, they attempted to go into Bithynia. Everybody following this? Yeah, you good? But the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them, so passing by Mysia, they went down to Troas. Have you ever had a bad flight cancellation during the holidays? And you're like, okay, so we started, we're going to go to Florida for the holiday, and then we get to the airport and they've canceled everything because they're Southwest, whatever. They canceled everything. And so now we got to find another flight. So I went to the other flights. They're all full, but they also got canceled. And so then I was like, Milwaukee. I heard that Milwaukee might have some people going. So we get in our car. We drove through the snow that's now falling up to Milwaukee, and we realize, oh, we can get a flight from there. We get booked on the flight. We get out on the tarmac, and then they say, I'm sorry, Florida just closed down because they don't want you, right? So now you can't go, but you're like, they're saying, hey, but you can, if you drive in, it's different. They just don't want flying people. So, okay, so you get in your car and you start driving, and then, of course, they shut down every highway going out of Chicago, and you're stuck, so you go back home. And you tell your friends about it. That's what he just did. Because here's what happened. All right, this is their little tour. Doo-doo-doo, red, okay? Bithynia is up here. So what he says, just so we get it right, I marked it. Here we go. They went through the region of Phrygia and Galatia. Phrygia and Galatia. Having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word of God in Asia. And when they had come up to Mysia, they attempted to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus stopped them. So passing by Mysia, they went down to Troas. So they, you want to go this? Nope. We want to go, nope. That's what they did. Now, here's the funny part about this for me. I'm like, oh, okay, they did that, but what stopped them? Did you see it? What stopped them? Okay, went through Phrygia and Galatia, having been, forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. They attempted to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them. Now, when you go into commentators and they try to tell you, okay, what does this mean? They're like, we don't know. And we don't know. It's not made clear. In what way did the Spirit of Jesus stop them from going into? Holy Spirit, Spirit of Jesus, same thing. In what way did they get stopped? So there are commentators like, well, it's probably a prophecy, right? Or a dream. But I read this and I'm like, well, actually, the language here in the first one, being forbidden. This word is used when the disciples forbid or stopped the little kids from coming to Jesus. They physically barred them from going to Jesus. It's not a prophecy. Prophecies don't forbid you. Prophecies give you information and you can choose to do it or not to do it. Agabus, later in the book of Acts, will come to Paul and say, if you go to Jerusalem, your hands are going to be tied like this. And Paul's like, okay. And he goes to Jerusalem, and his hands are tied like this. To forbid someone is actually literally to stop them from going to that location. Stop them. Also, this second one, they attempted to go into Bithynia. That sounds like... we're just talking, they attempted. The actual verb tense here is they were attempting. It describes a continuous action, past tense, continuous action, meaning it's the same like of me saying, I tried to get in, or I was trying to get in, which conveys a repeated action. Well, the second one does. So they were repeatedly attempting to get into Bithynia, but the Spirit did not allow them. Man, that sounds like providence to me. You say, why are you making a big deal about this? Because he's describing yours and my life, isn't he? Or do you make plans and everything just goes right according to it? Or you go one direction and just tickety-boo, man. I'm going to reverse engineer this and yep, everything worked out because I'm amazing. No. Dude, you're on plan Z at this point. It's taken an awful lot of time, but you keep trying and trying one thing and trying another, and the Lord is like, now wait. You can imagine Paul and Timothy here saying, don't you want us to be in the, this seems like something that you'd really like for us to be able to go into these locations. Finally, a man of Macedonia was standing there in a dream, urging Paul, saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. Macedonia is up here. Come over to Macedonia and help us. Macedonia, go across the water to help us. And when Paul had seen the vision, immediately, we sought to go on into Macedonia. You guys, in Genesis 22, where Isaac is supposed to be offered as a sacrifice by Abram, God comes to Abram and says, I want your son. This is how it reads. After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, and he said, here I am. And he said, I want you to take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and I want you to go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering at one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. So Abram rose early in the morning. Well, it doesn't take a lot for me not to raise early for the morning, but one thing that I would not get up early for is to sacrifice my kid. But he did. He rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. This language, when it says immediately Paul went into Macedonia, is the same kind of immediate obedience that defines a follower of Jesus. So despite all of the wiggles and turns and everything, Paul's ready, like, I'm ready to go, man. Whatever. If you turn me away from that, turn me away from this, turn me away from that. And in the moment you tell me to go, I'm good. I'm good going and I'm good waiting. Because I know that you're in charge of all the things around me. I know everything that's happening is because you want it to happen that particular way. Following Jesus means willingness to go and to wait. When we become disciples, we surrender everything to his will. Look, you know this. If you've been a Christian for a while, you know this because there are passages of scripture that tell you this. Come now, you say, James 4. Today or tomorrow, we'll go into such and such a town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit, yet you don't know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? You're a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. Everything that you do, every moment that you have is under the sovereign providence of God. He's in the going as much as he's in the waiting, as much as he's in the going. The problem that we have, quite honestly, is we struggle a lot waiting. Because my question with this passage, just as we finish this, right? My question with this passage is why put them through the, you know, weaving trip? We tried to go to Bithynia, it didn't work. Tried to go to Asia, it didn't work. Why not just back when he's in Lystra say, hey, I want you to go to Macedonia? Isn't that what you want? That's what I want. Isn't that what you want? When you finish college, he says, I want you to go take this job. You'll be there for 33 years. Okay, I'll do that. Instead, you're sitting there waiting. Okay, Lord, when's this door gonna open? I've applied 70 places and none of the doors are open. Where are you, Lord? Just wait. I wanna wait. Want to go? Can you just tell me where we're headed? How we're going to get there? Why does he do this? Why does the Lord make us wait? Why does the Lord take us in these directions? And I just got to tell you, the reason the Lord does this is because he wants you to surrender to his every day of your life. He wants you to surrender to him every single day of your life. Have you ever noticed that in the Lord's Prayer, it says, give us this day our daily bread? Where does he get that? Well, it's actually from Genesis and the story about God giving the manna in the wilderness. And the rules were when they got into the wilderness, the manna showed up every morning. But if you tried to take extra so that you didn't have to show up the next day and trust the Lord for it that day, it would go rotten in your house. They were never allowed to take more than they needed. They needed to trust the Lord every single morning for what they were going to get that day, their daily bread. You know why the Lord tells us to wait? Because you and I think that we're in control of everything. We think we control the future. We think that by a certain application of our wisdom or our voodoo or whatever it is, we can make everything work out exactly like we want it to. And the Lord places in our lives regular moments of waiting so that we have to trust that he alone can provide. I actually almost went to jail. I didn't tell the search committee this, so you know. I don't know if I've ever told you this story. It's actually a really important part of my history. I worked at a Christian camp a number of years ago in the 1990s, and when I worked at the Christian camp, we had a cabin, and they were really rambunctious, and they wanted to wrestle all the time, and their goal was to give you, to pull your underwear up, which they called a wedgie. So wrestle, wedgies and stuff, the kids were doing it all the time, and they used to say to me and the other guy who was a counselor in the cabin, oh, what if they do it? What if they do it? Oh, they'll probably kill you if you like. And we didn't until the whole cabin jumped on us one day, and we both were like, we're going to do it. We're going to do it. And so we grabbed one or two kids and we yanked, you know, and they were laughing and it was just so funny. Okay, so fast forward 9 months. One of the kids is at his table in his house and he's telling stories, glory stories about the wedgies. And his mom's like, wait, what? What happened? So she calls the local police. And the local police come and interview me and the other guy and a few others. And they said, did you give this kid a wedgie? And I was like, yeah, I did. I did, absolutely. How many? Just one. What happened? Well, they were jumping on us and they're just, it's the only way to get them off. It was a game we were playing. Did it. Well, it was this time, the time when people were like, oh my gosh, that's terrible. And you were abusing them and these sorts of things. So I went through a series of months where they prepared for trial. They kept offering me, you know, a way to get out of it by saying, if you just plead guilty, you can just, you just do community service for a year or whatever. And I was like, I didn't do anything. Well, I said, yeah, you assaulted him. No, I didn't assault. We went to trial. I sat there for a full day. 9-hour trial, we had to select the jury. The jury gets into the box. We go through this entire trial. I remember sitting at the end, my lawyer turned to me and he said, I don't know if we're gonna win this. And I'm like, well, what does that mean? And he said, well, it means that, you know, the sentencing's gonna be something like 3 years in prison. And what? Like I'm 19 years old. What? I sat in the front row of that courtroom while the jury was out deliberating. My friend Eric sat next to me, didn't say anything. He just put his arm around me. And I remember sitting there saying in my head over and over, Lord, if your plan for me is that I'm in prison, I will be your man in prison. Amen. And Lord, if your plan for me is not to be in prison, I will be your man in prison. I am not my own. I was bought with a price. I grab back control over and over again, but the Lord usually reminds me that I never had it. And maybe that's what the Lord is reminding you of right now. And maybe your life is the way it is right now because the Lord wants you to hear what I just said. That to follow Jesus means that you're willing to go, and it also means that you're willing to wait, and you have to wait. He'll show up when the time's right. He'll give you a dream in Troas or whatever. He'll open a door when the time is right, but for right now, the lesson to learn in all of it is that he is Lord and we are his. He'll make a way when it's the right time. Let me pray. Father, I'm thankful for your goodness to us. Your plans are immaculate. It's so hard to say when I'm sitting in the middle of them trying to figure out what in the world you're doing. So there are lots of people who are listening to me right now who have a hard time following you because of your call to go and because of your call to wait. So I pray, Lord, that you would encourage them, encourage all of us to serve you with everything we've got. Father, we have a habit of grabbing hold of the very things that we let go of. So I pray, Lord, that our actions of surrender to you would not be something that we try to grab and pull closer to ourselves, but that you'd repeatedly remind us that we are not our own. We've been bought with a price, and that you are Lord. Give us Jesus in all of it, we pray. It's in his name we pray, amen.
God is so active, so involved in our lives that he is orchestrating things in a way that we won't even be able to mess up this plan that he has, the ways that he wants to use us. A God like that, a God that's that faithful, what would we not sacrifice for him? What would we not give to him in worship? Where would we want not go for him in worship? So that's what we get to do today. We get to leave and say, God, wherever you want me, whatever you want me to do, that's what I'll do. And so if you find yourself in a really difficult place, like, God, I don't understand why you have me where you do. I don't like what's going on in my life. Well, we would love to pray with you because we know that God has a purpose and a plan for your life. We know that he's working out those things for his good purpose and pleasure in your life. So please come forward as we close and have somebody pray for you. If you're new, if this is your first time, I'll be in the lobby. I'd love to talk with you. I'd love to answer any questions you might have. For all of us, we're going in worship to the Lord this week to bring the gospel, to worship him in all that we do. And so as you go on mission for the Lord today, remember that you are